Dziękuję bardzo.
Okay, good afternoon. Thanks that you all have stayed so late. I put the title here in Polish, so that, but unfortunately the next, I have to give my presentation language because my command of Polish language is really limited. Now about patents. In the ideal world, people think of I have invented something magnificent. I apply for patent. I become very rich. I can go to a tropical island and live there forever and not do anymore. And if I'm a manufacturer, I can buy patents and I don't need an inventor. I just buy patents. That's the ideal world. But as you will understand, the world is not ideal. So there. If you own a patent, you can prevent other people from doing that. Even if somebody reinvents the same thing, you just can prevent it from them. And that gives an opportunity for manufacturers just to block other inventions, just to block the use of inventions. Well, patents also, even if you have a reasonable trade between of knowledge between inventors and manufacturers, It's extremely costly. Attorney fees, anything. It's a transaction cost in economic terms. They are huge. And well, patents not really. I needed there are alternatives. Now see whether this works. A practice pretty common is so-called strategic patenting. You see on the right, you see diagrams from a book called Intellectual Capitalism, and it looks like from the outset like directions for generals how to arrange armies to fight each other, and that's actually the practice in strategic patenting. Is the terminology is completely like military. How do you kill your competitor? It has nothing to do with innovation anymore. And especially in the world of mobile telephones, you're probably aware of Apple and Google, and they're fighting all the time. And this is a scheme actually from some years ago. It's you don't have to remember the details, but it's just very complicated. If everybody is fighting everyone in the Silicon Valley with using patents, I still have 7 minutes. I'm going fast. Well, these mobile telephones, they are particularly the so-called software patents. And software patents, they are an American invention. They have been, quote-unquote, exported to Europe. And they are very problematic. Some people say, like Joseph, he says, they shouldn't exist at all. My perception is that most of them shouldn't exist, because a very common problem is that they define a solution rather than a problem. And if you define a solution and get an exclusive right, then you can prevent others from solving the same problem, and that's blocks competition, and it helps to kill your competitor. And another problem is that there are often many patents per product. So if you have a medicine, you have one pill, you have one patent, and it's relatively easy. If in software you have a single product with 1,000 patents, I talk to people in Philips television manufacturing. They have thousands of patents for a single television set, and they need weeks, if not months, to sort all the patents out. Now, how to draw the line? I think that's still debatable. In Europe, there is technology requirement, but that's very vague. Perhaps that's too much detail for now. Some historic facts. Criticism of patents is very old. In 1624, the British government issued a statute on monopolies, which was really to reduce what were called privileges at the time. And the British government says it's too much, too many privileges. We need free trade. Problems with patents are also historic. The steam engine. The actual innovation from steam engines was delayed for several decades due to James Watt exploiting his patents. Now, some good news. In the 1869 till 1910, in the Netherlands, there were no patents were not enforced, and that helped Philips very much to establish his light bulb industry in Eindhoven. In Switzerland, there was something similar that helped the industrial development, and that I think shows very clearly that patents are, it's not legal logic in whatever way, it is trade policy. It's very much about trade policy, and what the Chinese are doing now, they do whatever they think is good for trade, not legally. Okay, some other, Ford, I skip some things. If you have attended the story of Vadislav, but Vadievsky this afternoon, he talked about the soft patents thing, and it was a major debate, but eventually it was rejected by the EU Parliament. And now the next thing is the TTIP, where perhaps we are required to adopt American-style patents, perhaps. Now, some people say that still, whatever, patents are needed for innovation for the economy. And then you look into the economic literature, and if you're interested, there's a very interesting paper from Fritz Machlup, who was an Austrian/American economist, and he said actually that there used to be, in the legal literature, there are four justification theories for patents, and he says the first one is nonsense, second one is nonsense, and it's monotonous, you guess. Third one, they are nonsensical. And actually his argument is pretty convincing. But it was 1950. Now we make a big jump. In 2008, the Americans are forerunners in patents, but they're also the most critical people. And 2008, there was a publication that said actually no company ever really makes money from patents, except perhaps pharmaceutical industries. But then there was other research saying that the actual innovation in medicine has declined ever since in 1995. This, the patent protection for medicines has been strengthened. So they're focusing now very much on profitability rather than true innovation. But all those economic concerns, they have very little influence on the legal field. And this is already my last slide. It's actually directed to you, because in politics, there's a cycle. It's the government makes policy, and it becomes legislation. It's executed, it leads to effect. And then citizens can vote and politicians can approve it. Well, in patents, it doesn't really work that way, at least until now, because in patents, no politician is really interested in patents, except a few examples. Vadislav mentioned this afternoon. And I think there's now a new opportunity, it's not on my slides, but the patent legislation presently is very complicated in Europe. And it will be concentrated. And people say, well, isn't that good that it will be concentrated? But there's experience in the United States where patent legislation was concentrated 30 years ago. And it is these specialized courts, they tend to be extremely fanatic pro-patent. That's kind of logical, because people sitting on those courts, they have studied a long time patents, so they started to kind of Stockholm syndrome, they really started to like them. And now in the United States, the Supreme Court has on several occasions changed that. They are not specialists in patents, but they have had good influence on reducing patentability, for instance, on business methods, very vague ideas, and they are very strict. The bad thing is that the present plan in Europe is that the European Court of Justice cannot be evoked if there is conflict about patents. They say